the kind introduction, and initially I was thinking I might give this talk in German, but then he said I have to do it in Austrian, and my Austrian is not so good. Anyway, for those who know about Germans and Austrians, it sort of makes moderate sense. So great to be here. So a little bit of an introduction of my group and what we do, and then I'll go through three things I'd like to talk about in more detail. So we are busy with a range of things. It seems to be a fashion that people put up their front pages. So there you go. They're my front pages, that's it, for the last couple of years. So we look at a number of different areas, but we try to interconnect them. So we're looking at ionic liquids, their structure, looking at them as synthesis media, and so forth. And then use them in part to interact with catalysts and with materials design. So we have a link there, so we have shared expertise. Then we use that in a way to make new photocatalysts, and we have made a completely organic water splitting device, for example. Well, we call it artificial leaf. We are activating CO2 as well, but we haven't found the formaldehyde and methanol yet. But you know, we're searching. Yeah. So we're looking at nanomoles. So it works, you know, but not going to be the next big factory. Then we're looking also to combine with electroactive materials. So we've designed some new battery technology. We set up just a company to spin that out. And then that's the sort of fundamental, very academic work, but we're also looking at pilot plant engineering and commercialization. And we are looking there in areas of renewables and in the upgrading, valorization of lignite. And that sort of stuff here that gets traction on the public media, and this stuff gets traction in the academic side of things. So the three topics or three areas I'll talk about today is catalyst and materials, and then this upscaling thing. So the first is about a catalyst that is a non-transition metal catalyst that's able to selectively split formic acid into hydrogen and CO2. The second topic is looking at the characterization of amorphous alloy metals with a new technique we invented, or we refined, I should say. And then finally, I could not resist this. It's selling coal to Newcastle, so I'm trying to make coal better. Not just coal better, but better things out of coal. So the first topic is that of computationally designed catalysts. And we're trying to selectively decompose the catalyst to hydrogen and the formic acid to hydrogen and CO2. The work's done by Ruth Amos, who's now at the University of Tasmania. So first of all, we use computational chemistry to design a catalyst. That's the Canberra National Facility there. Then we modify structures, because our structure is based on the MFI framework structure. Everybody here is a zeolite sort of, that you know a little bit?
Most of them.
No, it's just otherwise, I need to sort of make it more sensible. Once we said, in the computer, this looks really good, we try to make it. And once we made it, we try to test it. So, starting off with, for the experts amongst you, we used 28T atom model. This is just shown a smaller one, so it's not just all these blobs on the screen. And the first thing that happens is formic acid interacts with the surface, and overall the system energy decreases. Okay, so that's why it dissolves on the surface. Cool. But then as I go to the transition state, I get transition state barriers, and what you can see is that for dehydrogenation, which is what I want, it's much higher than for dehydration, which is the one I don't want, which is sort of, a bit of a bummer. So I try to reduce that energy barrier with my catalyst. These calculations are for using acidic xylazine 5. If I use uncatalyzed, if I look at the uncatalyzed reaction, it's even worse. It's almost 100 or so kilojoules more in terms of barrier to decomposition, which is the reason that formic acid is reasonably stable. I've introduced a term here called energy selectivity. So that's that there. And if that is negative, I'm favoring dehydrogenation. If it's positive, I'm favoring dehydration. It's just basically that minus that. So one of the transition state versus the others. So this is the picture I just showed you. So you can see that we're massively in favor of dehydration. If I now switch that and make it basic, I'm favoring dehydrogenation. If I make the framework a little bit more basic by putting germanium in, I'm moving from 40 to 29.8. So I'm moving in the direction I would like. If I put sodium on top of that, then hey, you know, I'm really in a good situation. Well, why don't we just make that? That's straightforward. So we all know, so this audience knows about this. Okay, you know what I've been doing. I made this xanthan 5 in a sodiated form, and I ion exchange and make the with ammonia and then a calcine to make the protonated form. Here all our XRDs, so we make what we say we make. And for the germanium xanthan 5, we do the same thing. But the germanium I'm putting in doesn't really want to go into the silica easily. So there's always a little bit that's sitting on the external surface. And so there is a... there are references to this. It has just been published. Anyway, that's impressive. And there's a literature method, and that is to remove the extra framework germanium oxide just by washing with sodium nitrite. What could be easier? Oh yeah, and we've got the appropriate pore volumes and whatever, surface areas. So now we look at our blank reaction. You know, this is our reactor, glass wool. We know glass wool is a little bit active for this, so we've got to take that into account. Here's our tube reactor, gases go through. This is our background reaction. Okay, so far so good. Now remember, I said this thing was going to be expected to be now quite selective, right? One was going this way, the other was going that way. So if you have a look, there's virtually no selectivity. It's a little bit, but basically we're dehydrating, and we see that by all the CO that I've generated. So what I've just told you turns out to be completely wrong. So is it a complete computational failure or catastrophic computational failure? Or are there acid sites remaining after ion exchange? Is there something happening we haven't thought about? So if I look at silicolite 1, and I just talked about TS1 before, so we love this structure. And silicolite 1 is very difficult to make perfect, and they tend to be defects which are silanol nests. Well, if I calculate, if I use it, what we see, this thing is actually a very good catalyst for that dehydration. So if I now look at the transition state barriers, in fact, it's the lowest for the dehydration of all of them. So therefore, no matter what I do to the actual active sites, whether I have a proton there or whether I have a sodium there or whatever, doesn't matter. The defect will override it, and that's what we see experimentally. So it was not a complete catastrophic computational failure, but we just didn't make what we had been calculating. And so that's, I think, an important message as well when one collaborates with computational researchers, that we've got to talk to one another and see, so what did you really calculate? What did you actually make? How does it work? And it's not all just rubbish, because think about this. Anyway, so now it comes to bravery and courage. And that is, I like to have my computational guys and girls also go into the lab so that they understand a little bit what's involved. It's not just clicking and changing an atom and having a very complicated calculation. So this lady said, right, germanium is good, isn't it? And I'm getting all these defects. Why don't I just make germanium xanthan 5? No person in their right mind who knows anything about zeolites would try and do this. Anyway, so she did, because we would expect this just not to work. And guess what? It didn't work. So she had she made germanite, two different types, octahedral and tetrahedral, a little bit of germanium oxide as impurity. So a failure. However, she's a computational chemist. So she said, oh, bugger it, I made this. Now I'm going to calculate what it does. So she calculated the different sites, protonated, sodiated, and they all, in her computer, say, this should be selective for dehydrogenation. Right? There you go. They should all be selective. And, well, we have the kit, so let's see what happens. Lo and behold, we get 94% selectivity in that direction, the direction we want. No way in the world would we have taken potassium germanate and said, oh, well, that might work. But you know, you might as well take any random oxide and say, well, that'll work. You know? So it's really come from doing these things carefully and with communication. So that's there. And if you remember, and this is even more important for the students, if you remember the zetacin 5 we made, and then the germanium substituted one had some germanium impurity. And then we said, ah, well, we will remove it, because that's what we need to do. And then we got this lack of selectivity, blah, 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 blah. Fine. Now, of course, with hindsight, or you say, well, maybe we removed the thing that was actually doing the job. So we made it all again and didn't remove it. And what happens is, indeed, now I get much higher selectivity towards dehydrogenation than dehydration. Not as good as this one, because we do have the silanol nest defects, so that's okay. But we have a much higher utilization of germanium per germanium atom, as you can see here, because we've got lots of nanoions. Now, the moral here is, if we hadn't washed it and removed the germanium, we would have done the job, and we would have said, selective, not all that selective, but, and would have moved on. It's only because we made sure we measured what we thought we made with great care, that, because this would have been a misleading result, right? We would have thought something completely different was happening than was happening. So it's really important to make sure that the materials you're using are well characterized, that you're blank, your background experiments are done really thoroughly, right? So before you start to look at data that you want to interpret in terms of new things, make sure that your baseline, your framework, the materials, it's all how you think it actually is, and work hard at it, because then you can see new things. Because this would have been a total, this would have been an experiment, we would have said, yeah, oh well, one of those, and it would have been a few weeks, and we would have moved on. Instead, we've got a hot paper and underlined. So there you go. Now you have to trust me that in the next place, I had a cold recently, so I'm sort of getting throaty. Deep resonant voice. So in this step, we actually then said, well, we have all the models for sodium, why don't we just put potassium in and see what happens? Well, the potassium calculations then showed that, you know, this looked a lot better. Gone through the whole thing again, and now we have even better selectivity, not perfect, because we still have some silanol nests. But if I'm looking at potassium germanate, I now have, in terms of in our hands, 100% selectivity towards dehydrogenation. And it's the first, as I said, the first non-transition metal catalyst, a lot cheaper than other ones than what one would use for this, and one can maybe think about using formic acid as an intermediary for hydrogen storage, you know, and given that we're not losing any hydrogen, it starts to make sense to maybe want to do that, etc. So that was an exciting result at the end of the day, from what looked like a complete failure a number of steps along the way. So that's the other message, I guess. Keep at it. You know, if nature tells you something you don't want to hear, don't just walk away. Think about, why is this happening? It shouldn't be happening. You know, why? The theory is saying this, my experiment is saying this. How does it? Keep at it. Because, you know, if nature throws you something hard, if you actually get on top of it, you might get a Nature paper or something there. Anyway, so that's the first topic. The second topic is a very brief one, and we're looking at the internal architecture of nanoparticles. And we were lucky, we got two things on one issue. So Peter Felfer, an Austrian. So those Austrians just drip of quality. And Julie Kearney, who's half German, so you know, there we go. So they are at the Australian Centre for Microscopy and Microanalysis, and they've done all the hard work. Okay, so I've just made, or my group just made, the nanoparticles and helped with the interpretation of what we saw. They did all the really fancy stuff, and it is fancy. So we just made a core shell nanoparticle, gold silver nanoparticle. We made a thin silver shell so we could see interesting things. Given that you mentioned the David Faraday Laboratory in the Royal Institution, the oldest, I think it's the oldest continuous experiment in the world, is in the cellar where I used to walk past, and I guess you were walking past as well, in the little display cabinet where Michael Faraday worked out you should be able to make a colloidal suspension of gold, made the colloidal suspension of gold, sealed it up in a beautiful old tube with a wax seal and a, you know, wooden stand, French polished with a bit of brass. It sits there and it still looks like that. After, well, he did it in 1839, so after a few years anyway, it still looks like that. So anyway, so we did that, and what we wanted to do is wanted to find out what is the structure of these particles. So the technique itself is called atom probe tomography. That's been around before. I mean, we didn't invent that. And what you do is you have a needle, and you hit that needle with a laser in such a way that you have 100 laser pulses, and on average, one of those laser pulses is energetic enough to vaporize one atom. Okay. Yeah, that goes all very, very quickly, right? If it was this time scale, you'd sit there for a long time. So we can put a needle of material into this instrument, and it will give you elemental composition and also, to some degree, 3D information. But it's always difficult to get high resolution, because as you hit this thing, it vibrates, it heats up, it expands, you know, because the first atom moves, or element moves, and then the computer program says, well, I know where you came from, because I've worked it out from your momentum, from your angle, all the rest of it. But then the subsequent atoms are related to the one that you removed initially. But if your needle starts to move a little bit, because it expands, or you know, it just gets or shakes a little bit because it gets charged up, then your other positions are wrong relative to the initial position. So to cut a long story short, your resolution goes down. And usually resolution goes down, and you can't do atomic resolution. So our bit is that we've made it really atomic resolution for this system. And the way we did it is we had a silicon wafer onto which we put the particles. And we had the step sizes of that wafer, we put the particles on that. We put a layer of chromium on there, and then a layer of platinum. Now, platinum is what people normally use. Our invention, after much thinking, I mean, it's so easy once you've worked it out, but after thinking, we said chromium should be allowing us to compensate very well for all of these issues of thermal expansion, vibration, charging effects, etc. Whereas if you have silicon platinum, they're just a little bit too different. So, we can go through that, but it may not be so interesting. So this is what actually happens. Well, this is a cartoon of what happens. So you have the silicon wafer, and you put a drop on, and then you can see them, like, you know, on the Spanish steps in Rome, all the tourists, you know, settling out. You can see all the little nanoparticles sitting there. And what we then do, we put, well, this is what looks on the top. We put a chromium film on, and then a platinum film, and then we cut it out with a gallium laser, molecular beam thing, and attach it to a micromanipulator. Now, I would have no chance, hell would freeze over before I could do this, but this Austrian postdoc is very good, it's very patient, I mean, if you have to draw a picture of him to recognize him just with a few line strokes, it'd be something like, you would have to have the face with the tongue sticking out. I think he even got cramp in the tongue from time to time because it was this, it's a tough gig, but he's done a fantastic job. So not just with it. And this is what you end up with. And that's our final needle. And in that needle, we have these nanoparticles embedded. That's what you see. That's what you get. And our resolution is actually, this is very conservative. This slide comes from a conference of experts in this area. So I always make it a little bit, under promise and over deliver. We believe it's more like 0.4 nanometers, so about 4 angstrom resolution. And we capture close to 80% of all the atoms that are flying off. So that's why you see some void space here. It's because we don't capture them all. But we know from where we didn't capture them, if you understand. So those voids are meaningful in the sense that there were atoms there before. We are very confident in the assignment of gold and silver. There's virtually no background. But the amazing thing is we can even pick up sodium and we can pick up nitrogen. They're very light atoms, as you know. So the silver, unsurprisingly, we colored gray and the gold yellow. And so this is what you see when you cut through such a particle. So here's your particle, and I'm cutting now through slice A, which goes right through the center of the particle. And you see what you expect to see. You see all the gold, and then you see some silver on the outside. Then here we cut a little bit higher in the particle. Because remember, we know every position of every atom individually, right? We just make images from this. It's not that we are constructing, that we actually have something we're cutting through. This is just a virtual cut. We just assemble it so it looks like that. So we cut through here, the higher bit. And what you can see when you take the gold away is that there's an internal cluster of silver sitting inside this particle. That shouldn't happen because we made a gold, and I showed you the gold colloidal suspension, right? Gold colloidal suspension, gold particles. Then we coat them silver. Somehow, some of the silver finds itself into the center of the gold particle. Now, you may think, experimental error, right? Thomas, put a sock in it. But in fact, we haven't just measured one particle. It happens to be, in every particle, at least one or two little silver clusters inside the gold cluster. So there seems to be something happening. We don't know yet what, but we will find out in due course. When you look at this, and just look at the silver, one can then start to think about also just looking at the sodium and just the nitrogen. So the amazing thing is that for anything diffractive, you do not see. If this thing was actually beautifully crystalline, you just wouldn't see the surface, right? Because it was amorphous. Here we see everything, including the light atoms. So we see the residue of the sodium citrate, the sodium we see here. And we had silver nitrate. So we see some of the nitrogen from the nitrate. We don't know what form it is, presumably nitrate. So a real catalyst particle is a lot more complicated than one than we think we measure, even in an electron microscope. What do we see? We see not the individual things, that's what it looks like. What we see is a constructive interference pattern of things which are quite well ordered. So it looks like we see something that we don't see, as often people don't understand that. When you look at a zeolite, you see the beautiful cages. But there's not a single cage. There's loads of cages on top of each other, constructively interfering, giving you that final picture. Here we see every atom. So I think this approach will revolutionize the way we look at nanoparticle catalysts, because people often say, well, it's a bit of a dark art, how we make it. If you do this, It works. If you do that, it doesn't. Elemental composition the same, size distribution more or less the same, you know, everything's sort of the same, but one works, the other doesn't. Don't know why. But then you hear sometimes, oh yeah, sometimes you put a bit of potassium, you don't quite know why. Huh? Right, well, you can see here that stuff like that can sit on the surface and change the surface energy, all sorts of things. So I think that's just the beginning of re-examining a whole lot of unexplained or amazing catalytic phenomena. We can start to play around with this now. And we have here the number of heteroatoms and here the number of superatoms. Now what you see is the more heteroatoms on the surface, the fewer superatoms. That's obvious. But this is an idiot check because we know every atom position individually, exclusive of all the other atom positions. So if our picture is correct, then we should be able to plot this. If we weren't able to plot this, then we've made a mistake. So this is just calibrating what we've actually done, that it makes sense on it, or whether we made a stuff up somewhere. More interestingly, with increasing silver loading or whatever on the silver surface, we have an increasing curvature off the silver surface. So there seems to be a correlation. Whether these are steps or smooth curves, we don't know. The resolution isn't high enough. But again, if I want to have a certain silver surface feature in terms of curvature, I might be able to tune that by the number of heteroelements I have on top of the surface. Right? This is stuff nobody's even maybe thought about, but certainly it's not mainstream that you could do that. If you say, well, I will actually introduce a little bit of an impurity here, I will wash the catalyst particles a little bit less well, right? Because often that happens. You have a student, you get a result, fantastic. Then you get the really good student to repeat it. Doesn't work. Then the really good student gets upset and tries for half a year. Doesn't work. Then the initial student has another go. And there you go. You just don't know what you're doing. Then the really good student has a look and says, oh, you work in air? Oh, you didn't dry your solvent. So often these impurities do the job. And the Kaminsky catalyst, I guess you all know that was the big story, that they tried and tried and tried with a particular polymerization catalyst, and then suddenly a bad student got it to work fantastically well, and that was the deal. He didn't dry the solvent. Took them a year to sort out because all the really good students tried to repeat it and it didn't work. Yeah. Anyway, so now the third topic, which is selling coal to Newcastle. And yeah, I think it's a strange place to store coal. But hey. Right. So, what I'd like to introduce to you is I set up two companies using hydrothermal treatment. Well, we call that sort of, you know, well, lots of names, but taken. So, it's calling it catalytic high. Hydrothermal reactor technology, because the hydrothermal upgrading has been trademarked, so you can't use that. You can't have something else. Anyway, HTR is sort of, you know, sort of snazzy, and ABC News and 7:30 report used it, so I think it's gone into the Wikipedia. I think may also be the picture I took from un-Wikipedia, by the way, about Newcastle. There's a very interesting page on Newcastle there. Yeah, lots about bogans and coal and doing wheelies. And yeah, I think it must have been somebody written by somebody from Wollongong, you know? As a piece of hate or something like that. Anyway, so I set up a company that upgrades brown coal to oil and black, high purity black coal dust, and one that takes biomass and makes that into bio crude oil. And well, they are the two websites. If you want to, oh, well, this is this tape anyway, and here's some patents. The initial stage, you've got to always think, well, what do you want to do? You want to make fuels, or you want to make chemicals? Because fuels are sort of good, because they're conversion. You can put all sorts of stuff in at the front, all sorts of technology in the middle, but you're wanting to hit just a few well-defined products, well-defined specs. If you've got those specs, and that liquid, people will buy it, especially if it's a bit cheaper than the original, than what you can buy now. There might be people trying to block you if you're really successful, but at the end of the day, conceptually, it's very straightforward. Chemicals, which are, of course, much more interesting in a sense to a chemist, are very, very complicated. They are divergent. So a single technology on a single feedstock will lead to hundreds of different products, right? I mean, you just extract coffee and do a GC on that. You've got a forest of peaks. So in order to commercialize it, you have to find a product that's really, really valuable, and that valuable product then can be extracted, isolated, and be used to make money. And it has to support all the other waste material that I'm generating, etc. Maybe, but once you start to make that in bulk, that value of that valuable product will also go down. So it's a tough situation. This is easier. So my view was, I'm going to make fuels to start off with, and as I have a market and some income, I dial in bits of my fuel and convert that to chemicals, which is exactly what the oil and petrochemical, you know, the big petrochemical companies all did that. I mean, whales got a bit, you know, scarce. Then people went to kerosene. Well, Shell used to be whale oil. So then they went to kerosene, and then they had lots of stuff left over, and they made increasing use of that barrel of oil. And now, of course, every drop is used for something. So in our case, we try to go for these oils and then make chemicals sometime down the track. It's also attractive for investors because that means they're getting, hopefully, some sugar here because it'll be a success. But then there's a trajectory for, you know, further rounds of, you know, investment, technology development, and future earning capacity and all that. And they like that. Well, I guess if I put in 20 million or so, I would like it too. So this is what the technology is based about. Everybody knows about supercritical. I don't have to. Yeah. Okay. Right. So temperature, pressure, critical point, bang, fourth phase of matter. Gas that is so strongly compressed was to be able to dissolve things, and still has the diffusivity of a gas. So it's special. It's much more basic and acidic than pure water, if it is water. We are using conditions around this sort of point. So that's our medium. And what we want to do is we want to look at these bonds, and we try not to break carbon-carbon bonds. Because once you do that, you get repolymerization, radical chemistry, all sorts of nasties. So we try to focus exclusively on carbon-oxygen bonds as much as we can, and cut them. There you go. Cut them by adding water. So we hydrolyze these bonds. And the typical one would be ether bonds to alcohols or ester bonds. Then once we've done that, we've done the wrong thing, right? We added oxygen to something where we want to take oxygen away. A bit, well, I don't know whether that's racist, but a bit Irish, isn't it? We then remove the oxygen that was there and the oxygen that we added, either by dehydration or by decarboxylation. That's why I was asking you beforehand. By decarboxylation. This is what happens. So this is a famous paper by a colleague of mine, Wim van der Zwaai. I think you've got known him as well. And this is a piece of pine in a quartz capillary and some water at time zero. And I now put that into a fluidized sand bath for a minute, sort of like this, you know. And do it again. So, and the thing is, I'm doing it this way. If the quartz capillary is not sealed properly, initially the student will do it quite confidently. Okay. Second minute. Right. But then there will be a crack, and this thing will go. And when it goes, it's really loud, right? And you can see the progression of students who initially are full of confidence, walking up and going, yeah, I've done this, no problem. And after the first explosion. Anyway, I'm hamming it up for this thing. Right. So, First minute, it looks a bit worse for wear, and then as we keep going, what we see is basically just a little bit of ash left, water soluble bio oil, and then here you see separated bio oil. Of course, the photo is not taken at 350 degrees, it's taken at room temperature or close to, so this was massively expanded and then has come back, and all the heavy oil sits, you know, sort of distributed a bit here and a bit over there, but that would have been not looking so nice. You know. So that's just indicating there's some heavy oil, and here's water soluble oil. So any piece of wood that you see around you, you can now think, hey, I can actually make oil out of that. You know, if in your faculty there's a bit of dead wood, you can think, oh, I could make some oil out of you. Tomorrow, Sydney Morning Herald, like, university professor, German university professor, advocates. Anyway, so this is a plant that we've got at Sydney Uni. So this thing is about as tall as I am. That's a big fluidized bed reactor, which has got coils of reactor coils in there. And, for the chemical engineers, you know, here are our coils. We've got four independent coils, so we can run them in series or in parallel. They come up at the top, so we can put instruments there, so we can monitor the flow. The biomass, in this case, is slurried up and put through a pre-pump and a very strong pump. We do some heat recovery, do lots of chemical engineering calculations and process design and all the rest of it. That's really Brian Haynes's group that's built this thing. I just said, build me one of them. And we got some money from Encris when we still had some money to do that. And so his students, his chemical engineering team, does all the chemical engineering, all the calculations, and all the studies and things. So off the processing, I care what comes out. Interestingly, they don't really care what comes out. They just want to know what happens, you know, to it as it goes through. So quite different mindsets. But together, you know, we get the whole picture. So in summary, so if you take some sawdust and go through our process, what happens is that you get this amount of bioproof. So the really cool thing is that it's the same amount of energy in each of these, and they're drawn to scale. So that is fluffy, solid, wet, full of ash, wood, not really useful for anything. And there's a lot of that generated in sawmills and its byproduct, and this can be a bit of a problem. And so we can take that and make it into this, which is dry, liquid, blendable, upgradable, storable. I've got a bottle that's now 5 years old in my lab that's still liquid, so it hasn't turned into a bakelite, because we tried to avoid that radical formation and therefore cross-linking. So that's a huge degree of energy intensification. This was a bit for a PR thing, because of course not lying, but I'm misleading you. This is sawdust, right? There's a heck of a lot of air in the sawdust. So it really looks like a lot of volume, right? I mean, if I compress that'll be much less. At least I'm alerting you to it, because you're my academic friends, rather than, you know, other people I want money from. You haven't got any, right? I mean, I presume. Anyway, so this is what works. This is how it works. So we start on a dry and ashy basis with 1,000 kilograms of wood, and then we get about half a ton of liquids and half a ton of CO2 and a bit of water as reaction product. Now, you may say, oh, that's terrible. You take a ton of wood and you're only making half a ton of oil. What a waste. Well, a ton of wood is basically half a ton of oxygen. You can't do anything with oxygen. So you've got to actually remove the oxygen from that, right? So this is a pretty good result. This is close to the theoretical maximum if you work it all out in terms of elemental composition, etc. So we retain a little bit of oxygen, but we removed a fair bit. In fact, we removed 82% of the oxygen in that feedstock in one hit, like that. And, in nature, that can take, depending on where you're looking at, 100, 150 million years. We do it in 15 minutes, which is, you know, not bad. Right, that's what it looks like. So this is a dry biomass. So I'm being ultra careful here. Dry biomass, so it says all the oxygen bound, the carbohydrate, right, the cellulose. So for each carbon, there's a water. So that's that amount of oxygen here, and then in one step we go from low energy density to high energy density, and then from there to there we can refine in conventional refineries, and I'll show you a couple of pictures in a moment, to make it into conventional products. So two-step process, one, two, and here we're really changing the nature of the feedstock completely and make it very comparable to crude oil. In fact, it's better than crude oil on a number of different, for a number of reasons. And here they are. Again, crude oil, you probably all know this, if you bring it to a refinery, they do a number of things, like desalting, and then they distill it, take some gas off, and have cuts, different cuts. And one of those cuts of the distillation column is called straight run gas oil. And our bio crude is so good that it doesn't need to be mixed in here. It actually sits here. So it sits in an already partially refined oil stream. That's where it is best. Then we go through a range of hydrotreating steps. And they're all different depending on which refinery I'm looking at. You know, they're all set up for different types of crude oil. And then we get our normal set of refinery products. And also we can get some chemicals out of that if the refinery is set up to do that. So depending on how many green atoms I have in here, I have that many green atoms out here. But the molecules are indistinguishable structurally. The only way you can tell is by doing a carbon dating. And suddenly your petrol is a lot younger than you thought. And there are issues though, still a little bit. They're trying now to change some of the world standards, because the oil companies say we only allow, or the standard says, which the oil companies help define, we only allow products derived from fossil crude oil. And then when you come with this amount of data and say, look, it's the same. Right, like thousands of GC spectra and GCMSs and everything. He said, well, it's the same. Looks the same, smells the same, molecularly it's the same. Yeah, but that, so I can't use it. And it's a barrier policy. And we are starting to now break into that, because California has legislated that 5% of all refineries need to have green in their product streams. Sorry, not 5%. All refineries need to have 5%. Of green in their product streams, and so therefore the standards obviously have to change, otherwise they legislate refineries to do stuff they're not allowed to sell, which doesn't work, right? So this takes care of itself. But currently there are some issues still. So this is what it looks like. This is our straight run gas oil, and here we have biocrude blended 2, 10, 20%, and here's 100% of this biocrude. Looks pretty terrible, you know. The reason is there are obviously aromatics in there, and those aromatics react with light. And even at a part per million level, they start to go like dark ink. So it's actually quite nice, but it is dark because of that reaction. Once we stabilize it with hydrogen, lo and behold, it looks all pretty good. So that one, 100%, I never thought the catalysts, these are commercial catalysts that are used. Commercial catalysts, commercial conditions, 5 days on stream, you know, really solid testing. So we are able to make the conventional products coming from that stream, and Evelino Corma, who some of you may know, in his lab that was done. So we are very pleased about this. Because I personally thought 10%, yeah, 20 I thought was a push, because of, you know, potential part per million purities that we didn't see but will kill the catalyst. You never know. 5 days on stream, stuff happens, right? Was okay. In fact, our catalysts, our material helped to stabilize the catalyst faster. Normally it takes 8 hours or so for the catalyst to sort of settle in his setup. In our case, and we don't know why, it was 4 hours. So, well, of course, initially we thought, oh, it looks different, it will be worse, but it actually was all right. And even here, the 100% did not kill the catalyst, and it was good. life cycle analysis, that's always... I need to... Oh dear, I'm running out of the coal. How much time have I got?
5 minutes.
Another five, okay. Life cycle analysis looks good compared to ethanol. energy return or energy invested for bio crude, we get 7 times out, right? So 7 times more energy out than we put in. For ethanol, it's 1.3 times. So we're doing all right there. And overall greenhouse gas emission reduction by 85%. And this was done by independent lot. Right, so now I've got to, it can be used as a blend in diesel engines without trouble. Sorry, now I've got to shoot through. Coal, which was my whole point. So coal, we can do the same deal, and we make upgraded coal powder and syncrude, very high energy content. Same principles apply. Well, I'll go through that. We make that stuff. Make lots of... Okay, that goes in again. Same as that in the straight run gas oil. Looks good. And now we did it with holotopso, and we made a fantastic jet fuel from brown coal. Who would have thought? And that has a cloud point much lower than the standard, and in fact so low they couldn't measure it because they don't have to kick, because the standard goes to minus 50 and they have to minus 61 and less than that. It has to do with branching and things. So brown coal just gives us a superior oil, and given that we can make a lot of oil from brown coal, it would change if the whole world were using our, was using our process, the whole oil supply thing would be changed dramatically from, you know, 2.7 or 2.8, so 2,800 billion barrels of current supply, including tar sands and shale oil, to almost double. So that whole crunch of running out of oil, we can avoid. Now, people are trying to avoid that crunch by drilling in the Arctic or the Antarctic, or, you know, doing seismic testing of the Great Barrier Reef. I think that's a really bad idea. I think alluvial mining, admittedly destroying the landscape because you're digging it up in a very well-defined area that you know how to remediate. In Germany, the remediation sites in East Germany now, they're holiday destinations, right? The stuff they shut down 40 years ago have been reforested. All the holes have got lakes in them, the holiday houses. People go there. You know, if you take a long enough view, it's okay. You rape, admittedly, you rape the surface of the earth, getting it out. But by good remediation, you make it into a tourist resort. And you can see it in Germany, highly populated place. So that works. So I think the good thing about using brown coal to make the oil is I don't have the chance of an oil spill in a, you know, pristine wilderness. I know what I'm doing. We've been doing it for hundreds of years. It's safe. It's very predictable. It's very costly. You know, can cost it very nicely. So, and also, I've worked out to give North America enough of our plants to make enough oil for them not to have to import, we would need the budget of 5 months of the Iraq war. That's it. 5 months Iraq war, they would be independent of foreign oil through their own brown coal resource and their own money. Just putting it out there. Okay, so we've got this micronized coal product as well. So we've got that oil, we've got the oil pitch, and that can be made into an aqueous slurry. And Louis Wibberly from the CSIRO is a master in this, and we're collaborating with him in this. And so if I take this black coal product and put it 50% in water, it looks like that. Quite remarkable, and it's stable with a tiny additive, 0.01 or whatever percent, and stable, and it behaves like a heavy fuel oil. Why is that exciting? Because, quickly through it, I have here unit capacity of power generation, here I have thermal efficiency. So if I have a gas turbine, everybody says gas is the way to go. Gas turbine, that's your maximum efficiency, all right? There, 35, whatever, 37%. Then I take the gas turbine exhaust, heat up some water, and run a steam turbine, do combined cycle, which is this, which is much higher efficiency, obviously, right? So 48% or so efficiency, and very large units, yeah, 500 megawatt units. So that's cool. However, if you look at low-speed diesel engines, the stuff they have in ships, And that's even more efficient because of the diesel principle of using all the gases of combustion to move the piston and therefore create movement and then you can create power. So that fuel oil that from coal can work in these sorts of engines. That's what they look like. And this is sort of my height, so they're pretty big. So they're 54 or 58% thermally efficient. If you reduce the efficiency by taking efficiency out for our process, we are still on par with the combined cycle steam gas turbine. And overall, this reduces the CO2 emissions by half compared to conventional lignite power generation. Now, in Victoria, what is it? Two-thirds or so or more of the power is generated by brown coal. In Australia, CO2 emissions, I think, are attributable to about a third to brown coal. Now, if I reduce that by half, I'm reducing by 15%. People are talking about 5% as being a major target. You know, I'm not saying this should be taken up. I'm just saying, as a technologist, I'm offering society opportunities, and if society wants to take it up, it's there. It sort of makes sense, but, you know, because you get the oil for free, right? You can make this stuff. And then you get oil on top. This is some technical stuff. It's cheaper than normal power stations as well. And why haven't people been doing it? Because until now, you needed the energy density of black coal. And the black coal is old, it's very hard, it's got mineral matter in it that's difficult to get out. And so the piston grinds to a halt. And in fact, that was Rudolf Diesel's initial idea. His initial engine was done water and coal dust, because he saw those big dust explosions in German coal mines and thought, well, if I can harness that power, I'm doing really well, and let's try and make an engine with that. So this is basically technology, you know, 101 revisited 100 years later, a bit more, and now we can actually use his engine because our coal is almost mineral free, so it's almost pure carbon, and we have that. So anyway, this is just it. People. One more slide or two more slides and I'm done. There you go. So this is your explosion, and the explosion, all the explosive gases move the piston, and that's why you get the high efficiency. Normally those gases of combustion tend to not be that strongly involved in the generation of movement. So it's not anything I've done, it's just Diesel's concept that is so remarkable. Right. So we could you know, this thing runs at 19% efficiency. We could replace it with this thing that runs at, you know, more than 50-55% efficiency. So this is a big one. So we would need about 15 units of this to replace that, if that's what we want to do. These engines exist already. You can buy them. We are working together with MAN to modify their injector to accept this. Simon Crean from the previous government actually was going to buy a smaller version of that, but still a big one, 50 megawatt version, with the new injector, because MAN is nobody wants to pay for the new injector, because the new injector works, but will it work in the real thing? So there are lots of smallish engines that where it shows everything is fine, but nobody is prepared to put up the money, so government has to put it up to de-risk it. So Simon Crean was going to put up 50%, but now, of course, it has changed, and hopefully the new government will see that he actually had a great idea, and they should do it. but do I want to do that? I actually don't want to do that. I don't want to put a large centralized power station architecture together. What I want to do is I want to move away from centralized grids, because the issue is if I have increasing renewable content, I need to have backup because the renewables go up and down, and are not that reliable. Reliable, but not that reliable. So if you are above 30-35% of renewables in your grid, the grid just becomes unstable. It's just a mathematical, physical fact of life. So you've got to have buffers in there. So people talk about batteries, people talk about gas turbines you switch on and off, but I think I want to talk about the direct injection carbon engine. Because gas turbines like to be kept stable at a certain heat, at a certain revolutions per minute. Ramping them up and down all the time, that means that there are a lot of stresses on the turbine blades, which means it's very costly to run. and they have long downtimes than when things are repaired. So these engines are much more robust. I mean, they're basically engines in ships. You know, they can take a fair amount of beating. So what we want to do is we want to move towards this distributed power and use this modified brown coal to enable it. So if you think about it, it's crazy, right? You're going to take brown coal, the worst fuel in the world. Everybody hates it. It's wet. It's inefficient. And now I'm telling you, with this technology, what we can do is we can turn it around and we can make oil, high quality oil, so we help our trouble on oil, and it's a last life. And then we are able to use brown coal to actually support the introduction of renewables and providing, therefore, a transition path for the whole brown coal industry in Victoria, which is quite important. Right, there you go. Germans like it. So I was able to berate Angela Merkel, the Chancellor, about this. And there's lots of coal in East Germany. And we're actually talking to both E.ON and E.ON, there's a joke on there for German speakers, E.ON and RWE, the two German, big German power companies, to do exactly that, to stabilize the grid with these decentralized units, which obviates the need for new, very large central power stations. And for those people who know German or can't know, this is the German press agency, Deutsche Presseagentur Reuters, das deutsche Doppelkind ist wieder stark in Mode. So this is, a number of things unite me with Angela Merkel. She used to be a professor of chemistry. She's German. And also, the German double chin is back in fashion. So... anyway, so this is the pilot plant that we've got. We've had 1,000 tons a year. This is 10,000 tons a year, and we're currently building, 150,000 tons a year now. So there was a video, but because this is going to go YouTube-y, I can't really show you the video, because I can't. I need to have control, a little bit of control, who sees it. And there are just my acknowledgements, and of course, thank you very much for listening to me and indulging me with my time.